what's up, people?
Now, that aside, this is just horrible. The thought that people do this day in, day out. The weather's crazy. I'm just gonna get out of bed. I've had enough now.
Cool.
As two friends, myself and Matt have known each other since school. After having had enough of just walking past our homeless people, we decided it was time for us to take action and try to positively make a contribution to the situation. It was then that we thought that being sponsored to spend 24 hours on the streets of London would be a good starting point. This video shows our journey and just a snippet of what rough sleepers have to go through every day of their lives that they spend on the streets.
All right, so we're here in Euston Station, landed.
15:10.
The plan now is to come out of here. We've been fortunate enough to have some clothes donated to us, mixture of, you know, jumpers, coats, jeans. So hopefully there's some people out there that can find some good use for those. So yeah, we're gonna head out now and see what we can find. So we're here with Shane. He's been here for over 2 hours. Nobody stopped. It's the first guy that we found here, coming straight out of Euston Station. Euston Station is just over there. Up until we came along, it gave him some paper and a pen to just write down the fact that he's homeless and he's. All he's trying to do is raise some money so that he can sleep in a room tonight. So up until we came, he didn't have any change. Put the sign out, and I think after about 100 odd people had passed by, the first person gave him some change.
What's your aim today to try and happen?
I just want to make enough money to get myself into a hostel sort of thing off the streets.
And are they easy to get into?
No, it costs money. It's anything from £25 to £45.
And if you can't raise £25,
sleep outside, find somewhere shelter, as much shelter as possible.
It's mad. And you can't go to a hotel?
No, hotels won't take homeless people. One taken, so I find one that will. Well impressed.
That's mad. And how long have you been homeless for?
6 months.
Alright. And do you see it changing at any time soon?
Not really, no. Not enough. There's so many people on the streets for government to keep cope with, to be honest. Let it go too far.
And I mean, if later on tonight it's going to get dark here. If you're staying out here out at night, how safe is it?
It's not safe. It's not safe at all.
Nah.
No. I've been beaten up. I've had my sleeping bag taken off me. My clothes taken off me. I've had money taken off me.
What, from other homeless people?
Yeah. Non-homeless people by urinating on me when I'm asleep in my sleeping bag. There's someone trying to set my sleeping bag on fire while I'm in it. It's that bad. And the police say, well, why don't you report it? For what? What are you actually going to do? Nothing.
And where was that? Where did they try and set fire? Whereabouts was that where they set fire onto you?
Up past King's Cross.
Wow. Just that, in the middle of the night sort of thing?
Yeah. Ones were like urinating on me with dry piss out of their heads sort of thing. I don't know what the problem was with the other people. Obviously not homeless people.
They just beat you up? just come up to you, started beating you up?
Yeah, like, when I had my hand broken, beat me with an upper woods. Someone let go of a sleeping bag. But they took everything off me. Not a lot to do about that, really.
Station after speaking with Shane and hearing about his story. We're now going to walk on down to King's Cross via Euston Road and see if there's anyone else who's happy to have a little chat with us. This young man's name is Christian from the Czech Republic. We walk by him en route to King's Cross Station. Now, he was a chef in a Japanese restaurant. Unfortunately, he lost his job and couldn't afford his rent and was evicted. He has been on the streets for 2 months now. He seemed a little bit scared, cold and shaking, so we've left him with some clothes and we're going to leave him alone now and continue on to King's Cross.
Yeah, what's your name, mate?
Paul Fort, mate.
Paul. And how long have you been out here for, Paul?
Since 21st of October this year.
And, yeah, like, how comes you're here?
Basically, I was trying to get off Spice. That's the main reason I've come here, to get off the Spice.
Spice?
Yeah.
And, what happened? What happened with it?
What was the Spice?
Yeah.
I don't know what you mean, then.
Well, like, how did you start taking Spice?
Jail.
Yeah.
So I went jail, I got told it was just like we smoked it. And then I don't even know, it must be somewhat really addictive, because that first experience, before I can have an heart attack and die. So why the fuck do you go back and do something that you've just gone crazy like that?
Yeah. Before we spoke about it, you described it as...
It looks like weed.
It looks like weed.
Like crack, and you'll go out to like you want heaven.
So, you said that again? And what did you do before you come down here? What was you doing?
Before I went to jail and everything, I was working, everything was fine.
What was you working as?
McDonald's.
McDonald's work?
Yeah, it's still a job, isn't it? You know what I mean? I'm still trying, still doing what I can with it.
And how come you stopped working? What happened?
I stayed through my missus ended up basically. We tried to conceive for ages. From when there, she's able to conceive for herself off the bridge. Everything just went tits up. And then from there, I ended up jail. Bam. We don't know where we're stopping our room. I'll be honest, I'm sat here, yeah?
Yeah.
And some guy's gone to me, he's like, do you want a burger boy? And I was like, yeah, I won't say no, mate. And he's like, just dashed it at me. And at that stage, I'm drunk, I'm not even alive, lads. I've lost my head, punched him, I got myself arrested.
Yeah.
But what did he gain from that?
Nothing.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, like, just being a...
Yeah, exactly. There's no heart or anything doing anything. anything like that.
And what do you say happened round the corner?
Basically, I'm sleeping in a Barclays bank.
Yeah.
The next thing, I've just felt up loads to my face, and I managed to get up. And as I've got up, it's like one guy at the cash point, and then I think it's his three mates over there. And basically, they're just like, oh, you fucking tramp, where? And obviously, I'm busting from my head, bleeding, I've lost the head. Trying to swing it out with like four guys, and then happened, got bottled. I got battered. Do you know what made it worse? Like my head got bust open, like I was battered, mate.
Yeah.
All clothes covered in blood. When I got to the hospital, do you know what the actual paramedic said to me? He's done this to get a bed then, mate. I was like, what do you know what I mean? I've lost the head then. I was like, fuck off then, I'm walking out. And it's only because the other doctor's like, no, mate, you need to get attention. Like, my head will come cut. But how the fuck am I going to literally do that to myself for a bed? Do you know what I mean?
That's an absolute joke.
Yeah, and that was at, where was it? Plasto Hospital, literally, that was said to me. And I'm thinking, yo, yeah, I've gone and got myself filled in so I can get my head down in a warm place. Not happening.
And what's your plan, man?
My plan is truthfully, I'm waiting for my passport, get to Portsmouth, Southampton, get on a boat, and end up in the sun somewhere in Portugal, Spain, somewhere nice. That's my plan.
Nice. And when do you reckon that's going to happen?
Literally, I've sent off my birth certificate because I'm from Nottingham originally. So I've had sent off for that. Like, that's going to take 2-3 weeks. And then from there, renewal of passport. So hopefully, about February time, I'm hoping everything will be ready to go.
That's
27.
Still, you've got life ahead of you, man.
Oh, yeah, I know, man. That's what I mean. Like, literally, I ain't down about it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I hate that. I see that.
People were, so that's for myself. You know what I mean? Yeah. That's the way. I've just got to keep positive. You know what I mean? If you set a goal at the end of the day, keep going for that, you might get there, man. That's the best bet I can think of. Nice to meet you, man.
Cool, brother. Cool, man. Love, man.
Spice is a street name for synthetic cannabis. Several charities told the Observer newspaper that manufacturers have begun to test their products by using homeless people as guinea pigs. Legal highs like Spice can cause seizures, paranoid delusions, and psychotic episodes. Users also say that such legal highs are more addictive than heroin.
So we were at Camden Station not that long ago, and sat down next to a girl called Serena. Looked like life had taken its toll on her. She looked like she was, you know, real fiending for something. She couldn't keep still. She was in a real
gurney.
Yeah, she was in a real bad way. Missing a lot of teeth, and it was really odd because as we were sat down talking to her, this man comes over, gives her a cup, and he's kind of hovering around.
He was
and
going in too.
Yeah, I think he was kind of looking for something. Any case, we didn't think it was quite right to start filming there, so we thought we'd have a little chat about it afterwards. Find it funny, this guy with, you know, some proper box fresh trainers and his bottle of beer asking us for some change. Didn't look like he needed it too tough, so we moved on. But what was interesting for me just a few moments ago as we were walking down the street, a lady selling big issues. Now, people selling big issues, they ask everybody. This woman took one look at me with my black bag, and she just shook her head and didn't even bother. So that was a bit of an experience. I thought I'd get down. Right, on to the next location. Yeah, it's like cranes
in the sky. Sometimes I don't wanna. Yeah, so basically we've just walked about half a mile from the shelter that we just walked from, and we've walked past about four massive construction sites with like high-rise luxury apartment, and then we've come to this one here which is just about to go up, and it's like, it's just insane. It's insane. Like, we've got so much poverty and inequality in our city, in our country, and yet people are just going along and building and profiting at the expense of people that can't even afford to have a bed. You know, we've talked about the foreign investment that's coming in, pushing up prices. People can't afford to live in even the capital city of our country anymore. Having to move out, can't afford the rent in a private rental. I think the lady, Sheila, who runs the charity we just left, she said that 9.4 billion pounds of our money is spent on paying private landlords to house people that are on government benefits and subsidies. 9.4 billion pounds a year. I mean, it's crazy. We're spending all that money on going to a rental, which probably could end up going back to paying for these apartments to private developers, and money that's not going back into the pockets of us as citizens and the people, you know, that can't even get a bed. It's like, how does it work that people can't get a bed when this kind of thing is going on? It's, I don't know, it's just crazy. Crazy. And it's easy. It's easy to sit there. Maybe it's easy to sit there. You know, you've spent a day walking around and speaking to homeless people, and easy to to get on your high horse about it. But I think the question is how much do we accept, and what point do we do something about it. Blue lights into strobe
lights, not blue flashing lights. Okay, so we are back in Houston. Basically come to see if Shane's still here. It's been about 4 or 5 hours since we left him. Basically want to see whether or not he has managed to raise the money to sleep in a shelter tonight. So let's go see if he's still here. All right, so Shane was over there by Houston Station, but he's not there anymore. So hopefully you raised enough money and he's going to the room tonight. We've got Winston over here getting some newspapers for our insulation this evening. Still struggling a bit with his toe and his beat up, steel capped boots and 3 socks. Don't know more I can say about that. Try to advise him to take a pair of the socks off. Hopefully he will before his toenail falls off. I think we are now going to head to Leicester Square, and we're basically going to plot in Leicester Square, and hopefully some passers-by will think that we're homeless, and whether or not they will dip into their pockets to help us out with some change. Now, this change is not going to be for us to spend on anything. Anything that we raise is going to be donated straight to the charity. What have we got here? Sales of luxury home, slump in London. Well, there you go. Sizzle. Alright, so the girl we were talking about earlier at Camden Station, who was sort of gurning, we've just come down
to Euston Station, and she's here now. The shifty guy that was following her isn't with her anymore. She looks in a bad way. I gave her some change, and we kind of face that dilemma, knowing that she's there gurning off drugs. But still, I couldn't just walk by and not even give her some change. So I did. Winston raised a good point. You know, after she gets another 19 of those, she'll probably be over to go and get her next hit. But what do you do? We've been here for about, I don't know, 20 minutes, half an hour, outside Leicester Square Station. It's Winston. We just sort of sat, plotted up on the floor outside a well-known restaurant. And, you know, it's funny to see how many people, hundreds already, have probably walked past us. In some cases, Winston had his feet out, walked over us, not paying us any attention, not giving us eye contact. We've asked a few people to film us, just sort of sat here, and he, you know, we're coming up to him just to ask him, and he's like, no, I'm not interested. It's like, what? Hang on a minute, we're not. All we want you to do is just to film us for 20 seconds. His friend did in the end, but he kind of was standing around pretty shady, you know, worried that we were going to kind of do something to him. You know, it's just interesting. And I think to myself while I'm sat here, how many homeless people are just sit there for hours and hours. I mean, we've been here for 20 minutes, half an hour. It seems like a lot longer. You just sit here for hours. You know, even asking, you know, we've not been asking people for money, but, you know, those that just sit around and no one wants to even look their way, never mind, you know, just reach out, even just sort of sit down and say, oh, you know, what's your name and how you doing and do you have somewhere to stay tonight, you know, how did you get out here, just to communicate like a decent human being. I mean, don't get me wrong, in the past I've not gone and spoke to every, you know, homeless person that I encounter, or, you know, I could put my hands up and say I'm probably guilty of doing the same as them, but when the shoe's on the other foot, it just brings the whole thing, you know, into reality, and how sad some of these people's lives must be. It wouldn't surprise me if we'd be sat here for hours on end without anyone approaching us.
It wasn't long before we came across another homeless man sat outside the tube station just 20 feet from us.
Is it getting better?
I've been homeless in one sense or the other for 5 years.
And have you ever worked during that time?
Yeah, on and off for the 5 years.
Yeah. And you said you've got stuff here for work.
Yeah, I've worked on some big projects. I built St. Thomas's Children's Hospital, which is a 12-storey glass structure, 12-storey glass drop. Each piece of glass costs about 10, 15 grand. I've worked on all sorts of projects like this, similar to the Shard.
And why aren't you working at the moment?
Because I've been chased around by the police and by landlords because I've been squatting houses because it's too cold outside. So I've been trying to go to properties with groups of people provide housing.
How comes you didn't manage to save enough money to start renting by yourself?
It's just too expensive. It's London. I can't afford to live in London. I can't afford to live near my work.
But your work's in London?
My work is really central London. It's on one.
So your work's in London, but you can't afford to live in London?
No, not by a long way.
What do you think the solution is?
For cheaper rent and for wages to go up. Obviously, but wages go down with the value of the pound going down and the rent is still going up. And there's absolutely no chance on earth that I would ever think I'd be able to buy a property or to save myself or like put my money into something where it just doesn't just disappear. Actually, at the end of it, I've got something that's worth something.
Yeah. And you know, what's your plans now? I mean, how are you going to get back to work?
I'm sitting here trying to raise some funds so I can get the identification and the charger that I've lost during all the mainly of the police not enforcing the law and landlords and bailiffs acting illegally and breaking the law.
Yeah.
Plus some of the things.
So you just basically need some tools and your ID card?
Yeah.
And how much is your ID card?
I think my ID card is £25 and my charger is about £25.
And that's all what's stopping you getting back to work? I mean, so far I don't know what we are now, we're 10 hours in nearly, and it's been like a crazy, crazy experience so far. Right now we're at Leicester Square. For me, the stories that we're hearing and just the experience of being here is crazy. And
whatever sick reasons, yeah.
And yeah, I think this is something that we've all got to look at. You know, look at ourselves.
Yeah. Turn out the beat a bit. Listen.
Yeah, so basically we've just found a decent supply of cardboard. Cardboard there, so what we're gonna do is we're gonna take the cardboard and get it together, and then we're gonna go around the corner. At the moment we're just on the back road of Regent Street, so we're gonna get the cardboard, we're gonna go into a doorway, pad down the doorway with the cardboard, and then we're gonna try and pad down for the night unless we get moved on. Obviously we can start using it to make up our
bed for the night.
So there we are, let's give it a go.
The dust in day, blind us slowly, but give a hint of a view to make it feel alright.
So I found a good little spot here opposite Burberry, and I'm just knackered. Alright, I don't even know what time is now, about 10:30, 11 o'clock at night. And I just want to sleep. Some of the stories that we've heard today, it's been crazy. I mean, like some of the things we heard about the guy being beaten up, or the guys being beaten up, was shocking and that. But also, like, the guy we just met earlier, Paul, and the last one, we met David. I mean, like,
the last guy, David, he was really inspiring. Now, this guy really wants to work, he really wants to get on. He don't just want to sit on the streets homeless, he wants to get on with his life. 50 quid is basically what he needs, 50 quid for his identification card and a couple of tools, and he can start work. But then he's got the problem of not being able to feed himself for 2 weeks when he starts before he gets paid.
When's he going to get his card delivered to?
Where's the card getting delivered to? It's like a vicious cycle. So, I don't know. But all I can say is, I'm so tired. I just want to curl up and sleep. And although, you know, we've done the best that we can, the reality of it is, probably ain't gonna sleep that much. So, I'm just gonna chill out, relax, unwind for a little while, and then see if we can get a couple of hours sleep. This is like about, I don't know, 4 o'clock in the morning. My cough's getting really, got more really bad, but and that aside, this is just horrible. The thought that people do this day in, day out is just crazy. I just want to get in while I'm in bed. I've had enough now. Not enough. I'm so cold. My bum, my back is just killing me. Can't lie if I'm wanting. I can't lie for more than like half an hour without having to roll over somehow. It's so cold now. I can't believe he would live like this. It must be getting on for 7 o'clock or all 7 people starting to go to work now. But man, that was tough. I don't really think I've slept. My back and neck are in bits. My cough has got worse, and Yeah, crazy. I mean, just crazy to think that certain people do this. People do this day in, day out. Funny how your day-to-day, your day-to-day problems or thoughts that you have about issues you have in your own life soon go out the window when you're faced with trying to work out how you're going to eat, how you're going to sleep, and I mean, after hearing those stories yesterday afternoon, like, I was a bit worried about, you know, our safety, because this is not safe. Not safe at all. So, yeah, I'm glad it's the morning. I'm glad we haven't been attacked or had our stuff stolen. We did have a couple of people in the middle of the night come over us screaming, shouting, but people that have come back from nightclubs or something, I don't know, you know. One guy screamed at us, "Oi, get up and get a job," something like that. Made us jump, but carried on walking. Yeah, I mean, I said it must be at 7 o'clock, so I just need to get through this morning and hopefully get back to normal life, because yeah, this is tough. This is tough. So yeah, so we're just packing up, finishing up. How you feeling, Matt?
Somewhere and a hot drink, that's like number one on the list. The wish list. Well.
So we'll come down to the American Church Soup Kitchen, which is just off Tottenham Court Road, and met with Robert here, who's just going to tell us some of his observations from. Spending, how long now have you been in London?
4 weeks.
4 weeks. Okay, so what have you seen in your 4 weeks being there?
It's been a big change for me. I come from overseas, although I'm English, but I've lived overseas for many years in fairly high level jobs. So just to tell people, there's a fine line when you between everything going well and being on the streets. Anybody can fall into the trap. My observations while I've been on the street is that there are some key things that I don't think are addressed by the support organisation. And general problems, and I would classify them. One is communication. Everybody lives by their phones these days. If you've no money, you can't get credit. Therefore, you can't use your phone. Therefore, you can't contact anybody. Most guys out here, communication is a big issue. I think the second thing is mobility. People in central London and the support services available are very spread out. Even in you take Camden as an example, and it's probably one of the best of the boroughs in terms of support, but they have support agencies at Angel, at King's Cross St Pancras, as far away as West Hampstead. Right. How the hell do you get?
Yeah.
I walked. Other absolutely critical thing, and looking around here, you can, with the guys in the shelter, is laundry. You stick your laundry in the washer and you get it out. It is a major issue when you're on the street. That, to my knowledge at the moment, there is only one place that the people on the streets can get their laundry done. Until April, I was a senior project safety manager, working on major mega projects in the Middle East.
How long did you do that for?
38 years. In various parts of the world. And my situation here, I won't go into detail, but it's basically due to family issues and overseas financial issues.
And do you see them being sorted out?
I'm hoping so. I'm hoping so. I will also say that the situation also results because I also have PTSD as a result of various. I was in Kuwait for both Gulf Wars and so on, so I have certain health issues from that point of view. And effectively, this is part of a breakdown type situation. But unfortunately, I'm not getting the family support.
So our 24 hours on the streets had come to an end, but for the people we met along the way and the thousands like them, their journeys went on. Looking ahead to enjoying ourselves during the Christmas and New Year holidays, it was difficult not to feel guilty. That said, the people we met each had their own story, and in each of those there was hope and a look to the future. I hope that things can change, I hope that things can get better. Sometimes hope is all we need. We'll be right back.